Hi, folks. The story you're about to hear is true. The names and places have been changed to protect the guilty. It all started when I was out in my ride, cruising around on the highway, having a good day. It was a Sunday afternoon. I was driving around and I ran out of gas. I ran into the most interesting fellow you'll ever want to meet. And I'll tell you, the rest is like a dream.
Gas in my rod. Can you give me a ride, man?
Yeah, come on, dude. Hop in my car. We'll head down to my crib and we'll check it out.
Okay, cool, man. Thanks a lot.
All right, man. Come on down by my house here and we can make a phone call.
Cool, man. I really appreciate it. Hey, man. This is such a cool car, man. What do you got in this thing? It really hauls ass.
It's not what I got in this thing. It's what I put in this thing.
What you put in it?
Right alongside you, my brother.
Hey. Holy moly. Corn squeezes. Can I have some?
Go right ahead. It's good for the body. It's good for the engine. You look at all these fields around here?
Yeah.
This is prime land. This is where we raise on that good moonshine.
No kidding. You make this yourself?
200 octane, 200 proof.
Wow.
Take a swig, man.
All right. Oh, that's smooth, man. Wow.
And the engine loves it.
You run it in your car too?
Oh yeah.
Holy cow, man.
Besides 200 proof, she's 200 octane.
Oh man. Alright, I guess I got picked up by the right guy.
we'll take care of you.
Alright. Man, this is so cool.
Oh cool, you live in a farm, man?
Yeah, you could say that. It's a crib.
Okay. You live here, bro?
Yeah, you got a problem with that?
Well, no, as long as you got a phone, but you live in a chicken coop?
Yeah, dude, you'll see.
Okay, man. I need to vote.
Not a problem.
Follow me this way.
Wow, chicken coop.
Okay.
My guy's not gonna be here for a little bit, so you mind if I hang out with you?
Not a problem. Why don't you have a sip and we'll show you what we got hiding around the show.
Yeah. You can tell me a little bit how you do this chopping stuff. I never knew how they do that. Maybe after a couple of these I'll try it.
Hey, it's a little secret, but after I have a little bit of that, sometimes secrets come out.
Oh, well see, maybe I'll get some secrets today. That's great. Man, this is where you keep your cars?
Yeah, this is the custom shop. I mean, you don't have to have none of those big shops like Boyd Totterpin, you know. It's a lot of cool stuff can be built in the backwoods.
Might want to take another hit before we pop in.
Yeah? Well, tell you what, this stuff is so darn tasty, I'll have another.
Oh,
baby.
Oh, this way.
Holy cow.
Oh,
Rocky, man, I think I need to sit down, dude. I mean, I am buzzed.
All right, Rick, why don't you have a seat over here and I'll open up the garage door for you. Running through the middle of the body, that's actually called sectioning. Sectioning is when you actually take a section out of the middle of the body. I always like to refer to it as the supreme task of customizing.
Sure.
Just because of when you do that, every single panel throughout the car has to be cut and modified. All the inner structure, all the braces and stuff as far as running around through. So you don't see people nowadays doing too much for sectioning just because it is so much work, and if you had to take it to the shop, it's quite the fortune as far as running around through it, the man hours that go around and do it. But this car actually had 4.5 inches cut out of the middle of the body all the way around. And when you section cars, usually what you try to do is you actually want to find the highest center point of the car, because if you're taking it out, you want to take it out even. If you take it out at the wrong place, now you're going to have huge differences between the top and lower half of the body. So that's where you'll notice it's kind of running through the middle. And I like the wheel well, like, so I can, you can see you can actually do some games where you can run straight up and over the wheel well, so that way all the pieces actually still kind of come back together. I mean, nothing, unfortunately, when you get in it really is like, oh, that's right together exactly. You end up having to do a little cutting and pushing and shrinking and stuff to get it around, but that's where you see a lot of the different cuts as far as through. And on this car, when you first thought it was a Cadillac, as you can see, these are actually 49 Cadillac quarters.
Sure.
When I sectioned this car, I like the look of the very big, tall fenders. You know, kind of reminds me a little bit like pontoon-type fenders.
Yeah.
You know? So what I did is when I sectioned the car is I originally didn't cut the fenders and taken this trim, which eventually will be on here. This is 49 Buick trim that's going to get mounted on the sides of it, and skirts will be running through it. But when I did section the car, what I did is actually went around the back side of the fender and drop the whole body down. You know, and that way what ends up happening is I kept the fenders taller. But originally, these quarters actually ended up heading uphill, and I didn't like the looks of that. So what I did is I ended up going around and taking, after the car was sectioned and I had that welded, I ended up cutting another 2.5 inches out of the middle of the fenders, and that's where you see these extra jogs as far as running through. So what I did is I took 2.5 inches out of the front, the nothing, all the way back here, and that way what I did is actually brought the fenders down so they became level, and then kind of started forming them over like I was talking about the pontoon type fenders.
Right.
And originally, I always liked these caddy quarters, and originally what I did is I took the Chevy quarters and I formed them over so they became like a fin, because I'm kind of partial to the you know, the fin vehicles per se. And then I ended up at a swap meet stumbling onto the Cadillac quarters. So what I did is with all that work, we grabbed the old cutoff wheel and the air chisel and cut those quarters off and grafted these on. So that's where you kind of see the green primer, you know, as far as running through. That was what I really wanted to do. And when I found the pieces, I made them, you know, I made them fit as far as running around. top chop on this, you know, that's again taking that section out. When you do a top chop, I always say if you think of like an ice cream cone, if you cut the middle out of an ice cream cone, that tip is going to drop straight through. Once we cut that section out, the top roof is smaller than the bottom half of it, so it actually would drop all the way through. And that's where you see these extra pieces that's widened out here, and you can see this extra top around the top side of it, because what ends up happening that we did is actually cut this roof into multiple sections and widen them out and lengthen them out. In the middle of the roof, right by the windshield, you'll see an inch and a half piece that's there, and when you come to the back, you'll see there's a piece that's about 3 inches because of the fact that roofs are kind of usually tapered. They're a little narrower in the front, you know, and in the rear as far as the proportions. So that was all bringing all that stuff out to go around and fit. And then what I like to do is you can see this extra roof section up on the top side is, you know, you could actually run strips all the way across the roof. And when you do that, it makes for a lot of excess body work that you have to do. And trying to keep a clean look, that's where I went around and I'll take a donor top, put it on the top and weld it around through. I like to refer to that as calling scalping it. Just like, just like the Indians that go around scalping and do it. Right. You know, this car is actually scalped. And what I started end up doing with the top chop on this, there's been a few people that have gotten into chopping fastbacks, and fastbacks is what this car is when the roof actually flows all the way back into the trunk, is one of the toughest roofs to chop because of the fact that it does it. And there's a few people that are cheating nowadays that right about this point here, they'll actually cut a line and just drop the whole back half of the body down so you don't have to actually cut into the trunk lid. Again, I don't like the proportions of that because when you look at the back, you see a tip around through. So this took a lot of extra effort, but this back trunk, I probably had cut in about 35 different pieces. You know, this trunk actually, where it's real shallow here, used to go real straight up and actually cut around. So again, with the 5.5 inches out of the roof, I took 5.5 inches out of the middle of the trunk all the way down to nothing that you see at the end. So what I ended up doing is all the inner structure had to be cut out, had to take those pieces, widen and lengthen them out. And again, as you can see, the extra filler strips as far as through the trunk, because just like the roof, you know, when you take that stuff out, it's all too small. It'll fall directly back into it. But I think the actual look of the car all flows very, very nice.
Oh, it's beautiful. It's smooth. It's almost aerodynamic, man. As boats are. This one here just looks like a bullet.
And that's the key as far as customizing. You know, back in the day, everyone always wanted to make them look like they're going a million miles an hour while they're standing still, and shave off the extra stuff that doesn't need to be. And that's where shaving trim, kind of a telltale sign of the Chevys and the old Pontiacs, is there used to be a chrome strip that ran right across the top of the door. And I figured, as radical as this is, we didn't want to make an easy tip off of what it is. So I actually removed and took off that stuff and formed it around into the cowl on the front side. And then getting to the front side of the car, if you look at the hood, you can see all the extra cuts that are running around the front side hood. Well, with chopping and sectioning this car, I actually did what they call pancaking a hood, which is actually taking a section out of the hood, kind of almost like sectioning a car. Because prior to that, this hood actually went straight, and with as low as a body as it looked like a big, huge nose off the front side of the car.
Sure.
So what I did is, again, ended up going around and I took 3 inches out of the front of the hood, the nothing all the way to the back side again, and the same thing, dropping it down. And just like sectioning, the hood was short from the top half to the bottom half, so all these extra cuts you see are all relief cuts to actually be able to pull the bottom and top sections out together to be able to go around and make it fit. And then the other thing is, with pancaking a hood as much as I did, that's kind of pushing it to the extreme of what a lot of people do. Usually they'll do an inch and a half. With sucking it down, it actually pulled it away from the cowl. So if you look at the cowl, there's actually 3/4 inch on the cowl that comes all the way to nothing in the edge, because that gap actually opened up from the whole hood being tucked around. So I actually had to rebuild that front section of the column as far as running around. You know, right now the hood is just kind of setting on it, because eventually I'm going to go around and have it open like the old Buicks. I'm going to hinge it to the side so it actually lifts up. It's still there's still some stuff to do, but we're coming around. You know, so far on the car right now, there's about 25 pounds of welding wire that you see in the car. From all these stitches.
Sure.
A little bit of our Frankenstein monster, per se.
How many man hours, so to get to where it is right now in this state, how many hours of man hours have you put in the car?
It's, you know, it's one of those ones, people ask me that, and I probably should have kept track of it, but I probably really don't want to know. I mean, it's really a very intense amount of hours as far as running around. You know, with the sectioning, you know, like what you see to an extent right now, you know, there's probably 150 hours in sectioning the body right now. And you know, the time with doing the top chop, you know, there's probably about a good, you know, 60 hours of the chop right now. And it's there, but it's still not done yet. You know, we have to go around, I still have to cut the interior moldings, and we have to cut the glass, we have to cut window frames, you know. So that's where a lot of times when people go to shops to try to have something like that done, there isn't many people nowadays that actually have the skills to do it. But, you know, if they have the skills, sometimes the people can necessarily afford to have it done.
Sure.
You know, just because at shop rates now at $45 to $60 an hour,
it doesn't take long. I couldn't imagine what it would cost to do this.
I fortunately have to admit, I'm really good at having an eye to be able to look at stuff, to be able to know where to cut it. But it's still one of those things where you kind of go around and you want to take some measurements, because you need to go through with sectioning it. You need to look at structure and see what's kind of unusual, and I should have some pictures, is when I sectioned this car and kept the actual fenders up, I actually had to completely relieve the wheel wells, where the wheel wells are actually shaped like those quarters on the top, because the whole body dropped down in the structure. So you want to kind of look around and see what obstacles you have to work around, because you couldn't make those wheel wells too flat, otherwise when you lower it, the tires are going to rub and you can't go around and go through. But what I did with this car is I really thought that I wanted to do about 4.5 inches, and just to give me an initial idea, is I actually went around and I laid 4.5 inches of tape around where I thought I wanted to have it actually cut, took some pictures of it, and actually took an X-Acto knife and cut out, because it was before Photoshop and all that stuff, and I'm not a big computer guy. You know, I like my moonshine, but I don't like playing on the computer. So what I ended up doing is, like I said, actually cut out that tape and just put the picture back together and went, yeah, I like the symmetry of it.
Okay.
So once I kind of knew that I liked the symmetry, I went around and just started cutting into the car and doing the actual sectioning.
I'll tell you, it's going to be it's a work of art as it is. I mean, to me, it's something that I've never been able to even fathom. I mean, how long have you been involved in chopping cars and sectioning stuff? I mean, did you learn this from someone specific, or is this something you just thought, man, I can do this?
I definitely got some pointers from my dad, you know, when mm-hmm. the time came. Is, you know, my family's always been big into cars, and my dad first was more of a body guy, and my uncle was more of a mechanic as far as running through. So as a kid, I was helping dad out as far as doing body and paint. You know, got pictures of me being young and holding a DA and right. DA'ing on fenders and things, but we did mild customizing, you know, never did any sectioning and stuff with dad, you know, so I ended up going around and went through and actually went to Wyoming Tech, and I actually okay. did go to school for it. At the time when I was there, again, they didn't do much for custom stuff. They were really teaching collision and refinishing.
Sure.
Because when I was at school, there was guys there that wanted door handle shaved and all that other type stuff, right. and I was doing it for them because right. they're like, hey, this guy can do this. Can you do this for me?
Extra credit, yeah.
And the teachers weren't happy about it, but they thought it was kind of fun to see a younger guy doing customizing. So being around the custom world, I really kind of gravitated towards it. It was just one of those things where, I have to admit, I have an eye where I can look at something and kind of visualize it before I cut into it and can kind of visualize what I need to really cut and widen and lengthen and,
sure.
and do. So, I mean, it can be, it's one of those things you can try to learn all you want about it in books, but that same thing, if you can actually apply it to your hands, that's
right.
That's,
I mean, you definitely have to be a hands-on guy, and it's a lost art as far as I'm concerned. I mean, you know, you think of George Barris, you think of Daryl Starbird in the 60s, 50s. I mean, those are the only two I can come up with right now out of the top of my head.
Yep.
But that you just don't see this anymore.
Yeah, it's a neat honor. Occasionally, I do run into some of the older guys that's been doing cars for a while, and they look at the stuff and they're just happy and kind of amazed to see a younger guy
sure.
is building this stuff. Because honestly, a lot of guys that are our age are actually into, you know, muscle cars. They
right.
want a Cuda, they want a Chevelle. And what's kind of fun is with doing this, I've met up with a bunch of my buddies, you know, the Hoodlums Car Club we did,
oh,
which
yeah.
has a bunch of guys that are kind of us goofy orphans that are into that custom thing.
Yep.
And, you know, birds of a feather flock together.
Absolutely. And I know I've met you guys and I hung out with you guys, and you guys are definitely into that. And you do a heck of a nice job.
Thank you.
I'll tell you, you know, like I said, this is lost art, and I'm glad you guys are still here to keep it, and you're close in proximity to where I am, so I can come and watch.
Oh, you're more than welcome calling at any time, and it's one of those things with us, you know, we always joke around and say with us being younger, I wish we had the huge pocketbooks to be able to go around and get some of those old customs, but I like a few of those guys, you know, that are a little more well-to-do where they can afford them. I said, you know, I appreciate it, but we're going to try to build history instead of buying history.
Exactly.
And that's what
yep.
we're working on trying to do.
Yep. And that's the whole thing of hot rodding to me, is keeping that whole thing alive. And I mean, it's important to our kids and the future generations that this is something that was a part of our lives. I mean, you know, from our fathers to even now our grandfathers. I mean, we're just need to preserve this as an art and a way of life, and you guys are definitely doing it.
Well, thank you. I agree. I think it was a fun time, and you know, if we can get some people rekindled, and you know, let's face it, we can get some of those guys to sell those Chevelles and maybe buy a 52 Chevy or a 50
exactly.
Mercury. I'm all about that. I you know, more the merrier.
If we can just stop Barrett Jackson from running the prices up on hot rods, we'd be fine.
That is true.
Yeah. But no, it really looks great, and I'll tell you what, you let us come by. Come back and take a look at it when it's all done.
Sure, you know, definitely, like I said, I'm hoping this next summer to dive on it, get a little bit farther along and start doing some of the filler work. And kind of the neat part about, you know, seeing some of that finished stuff is, you know, as a matter of fact, right, hiding right behind us in the corner there is a 65 Lincoln that we're
going
to do in a top shop. And you can kind of see that one's kind of that next step past what you see
sure.
here is when we're actually getting in and doing the filler work. And, you know, kind of the fun part is, you know, as we're talking about my buddies from the Hoodlums Car Club, you know, that's my buddy Tim, but she's having a swig off of the liquid nitro back there. You know, maybe we can get him to come on over and talk a little bit about his car.
Hey, Tim, what's up? How you been, brother?
Staying out of trouble, you know.
Yeah, well, you know, hey, why don't you tell me a little bit about what you're doing with this Lincoln?
As Glenn said, we're already to the muddying part.
Sure.
As you've seen it in previous programs, you guys seen it when it was more rough, and they got 13 inches longer, 3 inches wider, like Glenn was saying, and it was really rough when I brought it here. And as you can see, Glenn's the mud master.
Like he was saying,
his dad was a body guy and his uncle was the wrench. Well, that's where I'm at with him. I think we were separated at birth.
You guys are like brothers in arms.
A brother from another mother.
Well, that's right. Not to mention, you know, Popeye.
Yes.
Yeah. But, yeah, he crushed cans long ways.
He's got the grip. He's got the arm for that. Yeah, I was over here a couple times helping him, and when he got tired, I'd be in on it. And so, this ain't my cup of tea. But
yeah, it's a lot of work involved. It's awesome. I hope we can come back and see what this thing looks like.
Oh, you guys are more than welcome. Like I said, it's definitely the long cold winters is going to keep us busy. So
yeah, definitely got the place for it though. Here, this is great.
Well, thank you.
Yep.
I think we need another swig of...
I think we need some more juice, man.
I'm getting thirsty here. Yeah.
Thirsty and hungry.
Right. All right.
Well, like I said, it's been a pleasure. And you know we're going to have some more sauce here before the night's up.
I'm waiting. My guy, I don't know what the heck's going on. It's been a while, so if you don't mind, I'll hang around.
Okay there.
Oh, it's